please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
IPO market in India, we've been in a bull run this year. In this particular financial year, over 100 companies have really listed. IPOs raising over 50,000 crore rupees have already been clocked in this financial year, and we still have 4 months to go. Now, when we talk about this, of course, this year has been a breakthrough in terms of also broad-basing the overall capital market, because insurance as a sector did not exist in the equity markets, and now it's a full-blown sector. Is this something that the technology world, the startup world, can also achieve in the IPO market is also something that we are going to explore, and we are going to see how the things are going to develop. And of course, ITP is something which was an eye-opener, and it was a very good platform that has just been shared. I don't know how many people really know about it, but let me begin the discussion by throwing the question to Sequoia Capital, which really invests in IT, looks at startup world, and will look at an exit. And is ITP a good platform for that, Mr. Ravi Shankar?
First, thank you for having us here. And really, some of what Ishita spoke about is things that we should have known better, but we don't, to be honest. I do know there's been a lot of attempt to kind of giving companies a platform, especially the ones that may not be potentially large enough to attract enough interest in the main boards. But I don't think a lot of companies have taken to it, because there is, you know, in the PEVC community, there is the feeling that, you know, when you list, you want to list as a milestone event where you get enough people covering your stock, you get enough liquidity of the stock. One of the reasons you take a company public, beyond that being a milestone and employees have some options and they can kind of find value in the market, is also for an investor to potentially find an exit. And if we can't achieve that, you know, without significant liquidity, then it becomes harder. So one of the reasons people prefer to wait until a company becomes large is you want to go when a company's got enough liquidity in the market because of its scale, because of the number of investors that are willing to invest, you know, in those stocks. So from our perspective, you know, we would ideally like a platform where we have tremendous liquidity so that, you know, investors can also find some options to exit. But that said, we are very open-minded. We're very happy about the initiatives that particularly NSE has taken, and we'd love to kind of learn more and see how our smaller companies can take advantage of that.
All right. Let me go to the iBanker then. Mr. Yadav, what do you think? How approachable are these companies when it comes to the IPO market? And are you really seeing enough traction in this?
Sure. So if you step back, 2017, as you rightly noted, will be the best year for IPOs in the country for the last 5 years. The kind of volumes you have seen across sectors has been truly encouraging. Obviously, there has been a concentration in sectors like financial services, broadly defined, including insurance. And we're not seeing too many tech IPOs happen off the homegrown companies into Indian market. But I think that coincides with a couple of trends which is visible across the world. One, the rise of private financing market, where earlier if a company wanted to raise, call it a couple of $100 million or $1 billion or plus, the only avenue for those companies to raise that kind of capital was public markets. As we have seen now, there are enough pockets of private capital which is available across financial investors, across strategic investors, across sovereign wealth funds. So what that means is that the IPO milestone in a company's event is getting pushed out, which I think is a good, healthy sign, because all of us truly want companies which are truly prepared to be listed, not just from a business standpoint, but also from a management predictability of revenue standpoint, to come to the markets. Because then both the institutional investors, and more importantly for us as a country, the retail investors will benefit from that wealth creation, and they'll not see the volatility which all of us are aware of when some of the weaker companies have gone out and listed. So in our dialogue, I think, especially in the context of tech companies, we have not seen more dialogue or activity on the IPO topic than, I mean, I would say the dialogue is at a peak going back several years. So clearly, this is a topic which a lot of boards, shareholders, founders are very focused on, including in the tech world.
All right, so Mr. Bassi, when it comes to the regulatory aspect of it, do you think that regulatory-wise we are prepared in terms of taking the tech world and the startup world public? What are the hindrances that you find at this point?
I think over a period of time, SEBI has understood. There's lots of representation have been made to SEBI in the past in relation to that there are specific requirements for a startup company to list. And ITP initiative was a result of those discussions with SEBI. iSpirit also did lots of fronting on that with SEBI. And the whole idea was that can I create a platform in which the, because what was the demand from the startup world, that I cannot say where I am going to utilize the my proceeds. I cannot give you a business plan which it may work today, it may not work tomorrow. The third, so there are a number of such disclosure items which the startup boards were concerned about. And that was the whole rationale to create this ITP platform, whereby the disclosure requirements, as Ishita mentioned, has reduced significantly. The promoter contribution requirements have been taken care of. So a number of such relaxations were given to create that platform. I think, having said so, I think as of today also, SEBI is quite keen that more and more companies, Indian companies, list on Indian stock exchanges rather than going out and list somewhere outside. So they are willing to listen, and if there is a viable company which wants to go public, I think there are still some issues with the ITP platform per se, which GV has also highlighted earlier. Obviously, one is liquidity, and also from the perspective of the regulation, something needs to be taken care of. I think if there is a good viable company which goes to SEBI and make a request, SEBI will be open to look at it. And over a period of time, I think last 1.5 years, the SEBI's focus has been to ensure that the companies can come, list, and list faster on the exchanges. Earlier, the IPOs which we typically used to tell our clients will take 9 to 12 months. Now, the IPOs are happening anywhere between 5 to 7, 8 months. So that is a great achievement which we have seen over a period of time.
Getting Dr. Velumani in, you are the one who have experienced an IPO. Is that aspirational for a startup company, for a promoter to go public?
Actually, I was wondering why I am here. Actually, I am a tech company, because my web server is the oldest web server in the entire healthcare industry. So I'm happy that today I'm sitting here. Having said that, almost I didn't know anything in company law when I started the business. I didn't know the spelling of entrepreneur also. And startup is a word which only my son talks, I never talked. But having said that, there was an image in my mind. If you run a company, it should be a company which is listed, and you should be a managing director in that company. This is the dream when we start business comes in our mind, because n number of unlisted companies will be there. No one will know who is the MD of that company. But all listed companies, MDs, very often come in news channels to give a television interview. So that was the fantasy for me also when I started the company. Having said that, I went and pitched myself with an investor as early as 95. For just mere 2 lakh rupees I wanted him to give 3 lakh rupees for a 40% equity. Fortunately, he didn't understand my business. Otherwise, I would have lost a great fortune. And then life goes on, and we had never had a compulsion to get investor inside, because the company was very frugal. Company created a lot of internal cash accruals. So when investors looked at us, we had enough money in our balance sheet as cash. Mind you, if you go to an investor, you get, sorry for making this little more louder here. If you go to an investor, you get 0.8x. And if they come to you, you even can get 2x. So fortunate for me, they came to me. And then I was not needing money inside the company, so I did a secondary. And I was such a foolish man to do a secondary at 600 crore, and after 5 years, that went up to 2400 crore. But having said that, no regrets. because they came in, I got clean because I didn't know how to run a company. As a private equity partner, they always look for complete clean numbers and all numbers should be authentic. I perfected my business, and then after 5 years, they wanted to go out, but then they were not finding right kind of buyers according to them, because always they want to go with a higher valuation than what they deserve always. All investors, while coming inside, will look for 15 to 20% discount. While going outside, for my own company, they will tell 20% higher. So they didn't get the numbers. So they asked me in the boardroom, can we do an IPO? I just took around 10 minutes and I told, yes, we will do an IPO. Because I felt that is my dream also. Let me do it, and I have done it.
Great. So would you... So, Mr. Ravi Shankar, you want to defend your community?
Look, there's nothing wrong in asking, right? So the worst you can get as an answer is a no. So, you know, I would say you want to, like, the fundamental advice we get is buy low and sell high. So we always try. But that said, look, to his point on, you know, where you discover best value, I do think public markets have been in a kind of a tremendous run right now, and the best value today for most companies is available in the public markets. Now, with that comes a responsibility. So, you know, I always think of some founders thinking of, let's take the company public because that way I'm not answerable to anyone. You know, that's almost the thought process that people have. Actually, it's right, you know, exactly the opposite. You have few people to answer if you're, you know, with a private equity player. You have the entire retail investor base to answer if you're taking a company public. So it's a tremendous responsibility. And part of the reason why the process is thought of to be hard, and I just come off a process where we took one of our companies called Pratap Snacks public several weeks ago. Every word that goes into the DRHP, every number that goes into the DRHP is actually vetted independently. And, you know, the lawyers take tremendous amount of effort to make sure what is represented in the document is all real. Because you're dealing with a bunch of people who may be just believing what they read, and they may not have the same level of sophistication as a financial investor, as an institution, which can put muscle behind it, analysts behind it to understand something. It's a tremendous responsibility when a founder decides to take a company public. So we actually take it quite seriously. And, you know, today, thankfully, thanks to good set of regulations, a regulator who is starting to be far more forward-leaning, and, you know, platforms like NSE, companies are deriving tremendous value.
So if you have to compare the kind of valuations that you're getting right now, given the equity market bull run and the efforts that go into an exit via an IPO, what is it that you're choosing right now?
Yeah, I think the effort question is really a function of whether a company is being sold or bought when it comes to an M&A. So in the previous panel, Kunal spoke about it, and at Sequoia, we certainly believe this, is the best companies actually get bought. They're never sold. You don't need to sell them because there's always people who want to buy it. And when that happens, like Kunal sold his company in 21 days, you could have the easiest process if the other guy really, really wants to have this asset, right? But that doesn't happen every time. Maybe 1 out of 10 companies are in the position of luxury where they are so, you know, good that other people really want them and are willing to do anything, move fast and so on, and pay the best value. Most often than not, we look at companies saying, we don't build companies to sell, we build companies for them to be enduring, long-lasting companies. If you are an enduring, long-lasting company, a profitable company, like Mr. Velu is running it today, right, you would want to be an independent company for as long as you can. And at some point, somebody will really want your company, at which case you can decide whether to sell or not. So we want companies that can grow to become public companies. And going public is not easy, but for good reasons. Like I spoke about, which is, you know, what you say in the DRHP, how you prepare for it, the quality of numbers that you got, the diligence you have to go through, is something that you have to do so that the investors' money is protected. You know, from people that may take it very easily or find shortcuts. But that said, it feels like a constant improvement thing that people, you know, kind of can go through, and service is doing all the right things, at least from our perspective. But it is a tough process. You know, Pratap going public is almost like a one-year process because the amount of diligence and rigor required in reporting what you do and the numbers that you put in is actually a fairly laborious process, and lots of people, you know, multiple eyes are applied, maybe hundreds of eyes are applied on the document before it goes through, so that takes time.
But your peers don't think the way you are thinking, because most of the IPOs, in fact, the entire IPO market has thrived on the basis of exits by the financial investors, at least in the last 1 year. And that expected to really continue, Mr. Yadav?
So as you think about why companies go public, right, as Dr. Velu said, There are a variety of reasons. First, it's once in a lifetime event, literally speaking, for companies. As you think about the global context, I would say there would probably be a handful of companies you could name which have continued to stay private despite reaching scale, which is not trivial, which means it's natural for companies to think of going public at a first level. Two, I would say it gives a recognition for everyone, the founders, the investors, more importantly, employees, because given the huge branding event which an IPO creates, it leads to a feeling of pride for employees who can tell people they know, their relatives, their friends, that I work for that company. Obviously, all that assumes that the IPO is doing well. Otherwise, the same employees may not want to say that. It also gives company access to capital. It gives the company an independent benchmark of value, which is relevant. And in some cases, it also gives them the currency to consolidate the industry. So in that context, I would say, while the recent crop of companies are being driven more by financial investors to look at exits, that's a natural cycle of evolution, where companies need capital to grow. As GV and Dr. Velu would say, those companies are also raising capital to grow their businesses and take it to the next level.
So while domestic liquidity has been one of the big factors why we've seen so many IPOs, Mr. Basi, help us understand, how will this momentum really continue? What are the factors that make the IPO market more sustainable in the long run?
I think a few points. Like, as of today, there is lots of liquidity. And why so much money is coming into the equity markets? Because for retail investors, as of today, there are not too many options to invest. The post-tax return on a debt is hardly anything to talk about. So it is a phenomena which happened earlier in the US, where the debt return went down. So hence more and more money is coming into the equity markets. So that phenomena is getting repeated here in India. And if you see in the earlier sessions, we talked about the AIFs. Lots of domestic money is getting pulled through the AIFs, which is the first level of funding which is going into these markets, into the new companies. And then once, as Kamal mentioned, once they reach a particular stage, that is the time when they will come and hit the markets. So I think the investments which happened in these companies in last 8 to 10 years, now those companies have reached a scale where they are in a position to come and hit the market. They are the right scale, right size, and the investors are also happy and willing to put monies into it. So as long as this cycle goes on, I think we will have a very healthy capital markets, and more IPOs will come and list in India.
So Dr. Vaimani, tell us about the pressures and the pains post-listing, because that's also a deciding factor for a company to go public.
I'll come to that later. Before that, I'll tell you how this all valuations got built up. In 2010, I was asked by someone, do you want to meet an investor? Yes. He wants stock in your company. They are valuing it as 200 crore. He told me the number, so I had a courage to tell 400 crore because I did not want to sell it. Was making no debt in the books. No one need to be given any exit. So they did not like it. They went away. When they came back again after 2 quarters, I had courage to tell 500 crore. Mind you, there was no Excel sheet, there was no multiples, nothing. I just said the number. Second time they went away, but when they came the third time, I had once again a courage to tell 600 crore. And I diluted at 25%. After some more time somebody came, I told 1200 crores. Then also another 10% got diluted. Another 5 years ago, I had to do an IPO. These people didn't get a proper party to exit, so they came to me. I wanted to do at 1800 crore. Thinking that is sufficient enough for that investor. Then comes anchor investors whom I have met in the roadshow. All of them wanted entire stock, if possible, at 2400 crore. I myself did not know how the values keep moving up. No one knows what is your value until the true value is from the IPO market. Remaining values are all probably your perception or somebody else's perception. Finally, I got 75 times subscribed. When I got 75 times subscribed, when we were enjoying the party, we received a lawyer notice. The lawyer notice said, you have cheated us. Fortunately, in the list of the parties whom they have told us cheated, even National Stock Exchange was there, SEBI also was there. So I was relaxing. That should not be my problem. There was some technical glitch when they came for submitting the IPO bid, it did not work. So that went to the High Court. We had to go to the High Court, otherwise the IPO was to get stayed. And then in the High Court, the judge is asking very simple question, very difficult to imagine also. Do you have objection in taking this money? Have you ever seen a High Court judge asking, do you have objection in taking this money? And I said no, and the judgment was, take this money. And now if I don't take, it is contempt of the court. So jagi Bhagavan deta hai, chappad vaad ke nahi deta hai, High Court se bhi dilata hai.
I must thank all the panelists here for their insights, and it was a very enriching discussion. Thank you all so much. Thank you.